Greetings, everyone. Yes, it's time to talk a little bit about the new Christopher Nolan movie, Tenet. And I went with a group of dear friends to watch the movie on Monday. And I really have enjoyed Christopher Nolan's exploration of the topic of time. My particular interest in time is its understanding that it cannot block the light of truth to who we are. And so I have really enjoyed various Christopher Nolan movies, Memento, Inception. Of course, the Tenet is now the latest release, and Tenet is being shown worldwide. When I look at Christopher Nolan's work, I really admire that Inception explored the topic of the mind, the unconscious mind, dreams, and the use of memory. I feel all these aspects are very important in coming to true peace of mind and healing. And while I thought the presentation in Inception was quite spectacular and intriguing, the aspect of the movie that I was most inspired by was the totem that was chosen, each person choosing a totem to remember that they are dreaming as a reminder. And then at the very end, the final scene of Inception, the spinning top, the totem, reminding that the mind is dreaming, that the mind is still dreaming. And this is really the message from Jesus in A Course in Miracles, that the mind has fallen asleep and it's dreaming a dream, but it has forgotten that it is dreaming. And the function of the teacher of God or the miracle worker is the remembrance of dreaming. That is the function. And that is what forgiveness is. That is what healing is. That is what spiritual awakening is simple, just a simple recognition. I am the dreamer of the dream. So I'd like to explore the movie Tenet for a second in the context of spiritual awakening. And many thanks to Christopher Nolan for his beautiful explorations in the form of Hollywood movies. Tenet is a principle or a belief, and the basic belief that underlies the movie Tenet is that the time moves in one direction, and in physics this is equated with entropy, the relationship between objects, the forward movement seemingly increasing in energy, and the basic idea that entropy moves forward and objects cannot go back to their original form. Also, entropy has been talked about as the whole cosmos, time and space, kind of moving in the direction towards a destruction. And in the movie Tenet, the idea of time inversion is explored, which is reversing entropy. And it's a sense of localized time inversion in the sense that it's the idea that future society invents a possibility of reversing entropy and thus being able to have people or weapons or things, objects, reversed in time. So it's like an inverse movement of time so that they can seem to go backwards. And the premise also sets up the belief that the past is different from the future, and therefore, in this scenario, they can seem to be at war, where there can be agents that are acting in present time that are opposed to forces from future time that could bring about the destruction of the world. So this movie is, again, based on the premise of that distinction and that a world destruction or a world war needs to be prevented. Thus setting up a movie where there is an attempt to prevent the destruction of the world. And yet, when we look at the concepts of past and present and future, we need to begin to see that as the mind is dreaming this world, dreaming this cosmos, that actually the past and the future are the same in the sense they are the past. They are the belief that you can leave eternity, that you can fall from grace, and that you can become identified with a new time-space identity called a body, and that this body is invented, but it can seem to be of identity substitute, a substitute for the eternal identity that I will call Christ. An eternal identity that was created by God and remains eternal. And what I'm going to be sharing is that eternity is reality. That which is infinite, that which lasts forever, that which never passes away, that which is changeless, that is reality. And the dimensions that we call time and space, and all the dimensions associated with time and space, are actually projections of the belief in separation from God. A belief that has no reality. This is the core of spiritual awakening, to release that which is not true and accept and embrace that which is true. Hence, we have a beautiful teaching from Jesus Christ in A Course in Miracles, in which the introduction summarizes the teachings of the Course. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Herein lies the peace of God. Spiritual awakening is remembering. Instead of the idea of reversing time, a time inversion, which is the basic core underlying belief of the movie Tenet, I will present the beautiful idea that this world is amnesia, it's sleep, it's forgetting heaven, forgetting eternity, forgetting eternal life, forgetting God. And now, with the mind sleeping and believing in time and space as a reality, as an actuality, there needs to be a reverse amnesia. Spiritual awakening is reverse amnesia. If amnesia was forgetting God, reverse amnesia is remembering God. If this world was an attempt to deny eternity, deny eternal love, deny eternal life, then reverse amnesia is the desire to awaken to eternal life, awaken to eternity. So the movie itself, again, is exploring a concept of time inversion, reversing entropy, when actually entropy itself is impossible because there is no energy movement or exchange between objects. All of the objects are projections of the ego. The past is a projection of the ego, the belief in separation. The future is also a projection of the ego, of separation. All of the objects, the things, the people, everything of time and space is a projection of the guilt of believing that separation from source, separation from God is possible. So my tenet is reverse amnesia is now possible. Remembering God is possible. More than possible. It's inevitable. You cannot be something that you were not created to be. You cannot take on a form of time and space when your creation is eternal, is never-ending, is changeless, is infinite. And Jesus taught us, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Jesus was teaching divine spirit, divine love, the I am presence. Before Abraham was, I am. Before time was, I am. That the present and the presence of God's love is prior to the belief in time. And thus, the remembrance of God is the remembrance of a state of mind before time was or seemed to be. This is the core of spiritual awakening. This is the core of the teachings of Jesus Christ. The I am presence is before time was. And the past and the future are constructs invented by the ego to defend against the present moment. The present moment, the closest approximation to eternity. The present moment, the gateway or the portal in the mind to I am as God created me. This is the word of God, capital W, I am as God created me. I live in the mind of God. So when we look at the movie Tenet, we can see that the premises, the assumptions are that the past has a reality. The future, according to these false assumptions, has a reality. And the belief that the past and future can meet or collide or interact in some way that has to be avoided. There is no battle between the past and the future because both are inventions, fictitious predictions of the ego. And the truth is divine innocence, is eternity. Of course, innocence must be eternal. And all of the plots of intrigue and mystery and all of the battles are nothing more than a projection of the belief in separation from God, the belief in separation from Source. We learn from Jesus Christ that truth does not fight against illusions, nor do illusions fight against the truth. Illusions battle only with themselves. And this teaching is applied even to the premise in Tenet that somehow the past and the future are at odds, that somehow the present is caught in a war between the past and the future. But this little blip of time the ego calls the present, it placed in the middle of the past and the future, and it regards the present as powerless. You might say a powerless victim between past and future, when actually the ego invented the past and future and doesn't know what the present is. The ego doesn't know the divine innocence of the I Am presence. The ego knows nothing, being an illusion. So it cannot be that linear time can be inverted, because time moving forward is also a false construct. And time being inverted, as if entropy could be reversed and time could move in reverse motion and move backwards, also is equally false. All concepts of linear time have no basis in reality. Time and eternity cannot coexist, because eternity is real and linear time is not. To awaken to God, the focus must always be on the present moment, the power of now, as Eckhart Tolle talks about. The power of now. What time can, but now can truth be known? Now is the only time there is. And the focus on this moment is our focus on choice and the focus on releasing choice, which is forgiveness. Atonement is the correction to the belief in linear time, and atonement can only be accepted now. This holy instant offers everything. Now is the gateway to eternity. And so I share with you the undoing of the belief in linear time, as well as the belief that time moves forward. Time moving forward is an illusion in which the belief is something can be added to the script. An element can always be added, and that produces the illusion of the movement of time in a forward direction. Actually, everything is the past. As lesson number 7 in the workbook of A Course in Miracles teaches, I see only the past. I perceive only the past. The 5 senses perceive only the past. The body and the world and time and space are past. The world was over long ago, and the trick is that time, it seems to be a construct in which figures come and go magically. But this illusion has no source and no basis in reality. When we begin to question these beliefs of linear time, we approach the atonement or complete forgiveness, the release of all time and space, the opening to the remembrance of God, of the I Am presence, of the I am as God created me fact. So I ask you to sit back as a deep meditation and listen to the teachings of Jesus Christ from A Course in Miracles that point to the remembrance of God, that assist in releasing the guilt of the past, which is over and gone. The Holy Spirit answered the belief in separation instantly, simultaneously, and the correction remains as the only option for the sleeping mind to experience reality, to experience eternity. Atonement is the first miracle and the last miracle and all the miracles in between. Atonement is the awareness that the separation never occurred. Love is real. From A Course in Miracles, God in his knowledge is not waiting, but his kingdom is bereft while you wait. All the sons of God are waiting for your return, just as you are waiting for theirs. Delay does not matter in eternity, but it is tragic in time. You have elected to be in time rather than eternity, and therefore believe you are in time. Yet your election is both free and alterable. You do not belong in time. Your place is only in eternity, where God himself placed you forever. Guilt feelings are the preservers of time. They induce fears of retaliation or abandonment, and thus ensure that the future will be like the past. This is the ego's continuity. It gives the ego a false sense of security by believing that you cannot escape from it. But you can and must. God offers you the continuity of eternity in exchange. When you choose to make this exchange, you will simultaneously exchange guilt for joy, viciousness for love, and pain for peace. My role is only to unchain your will and set it free. Your ego cannot accept this freedom and will oppose it at every possible moment and in every possible way. And as its maker, you recognize what it can do because you gave it the power to do it. In the strange world that you have made, the Son of God has sinned. How could you see him then? By making him invisible, the world of retribution rose in the black cloud of guilt that you accepted, and you hold it dear. For the blamelessness of Christ is the proof that the ego never was and can never be. Without guilt, the ego has no life. And God's Son is without guilt. As you look upon yourself and judge what you do honestly, you may be tempted to wonder how you can be guiltless. Yet consider this: You are not guiltless in time, but in eternity. You have, quote, sinned in the past, but there is no past. Always has no direction. Time seems to go in one direction, but when you reach its end, it will roll up like a long carpet spread along the past behind you and will disappear. As long as you believe the Son of God is guilty, you will walk along this carpet, believing that it leads to death. And the journey will seem long and cruel and senseless, for so it is. The ego has a strange notion of time, and it is with this notion that your questioning might well begin. The ego invests heavily in the past, and in the end believes that the past is the only aspect of time that is meaningful. Remember that its emphasis on guilt enables it to ensure its continuity by making the future like the past and thus avoiding the present. By the notion of paying for the past in the past becomes the determiner of the future, making them continuous without an intervening present. For the ego regards the present only as a brief transition to the future, in which it brings the past to the future by interpreting the present in past terms. Now has no meaning to the ego. The present merely reminds it of past hurts, and it reacts to the present as if it were the past. The ego cannot tolerate release from the past, and although the past is over, the ego tries to preserve its image by responding as if it were present. It dictates your reactions to those you meet in the present from a past reference point, obscuring their present reality. In effect, if you follow the ego's dictates, you will react to your brother as though he were someone else, and this will surely prevent you from recognizing him as he is. And you will receive messages from him out of your own past because, by making it real in the present, you are forbidding yourself to let it go. You thus deny yourself the message of release that every brother offers you now. The shadowy figures from the past are precisely what you must escape. They are not real and have no hold over you unless you bring them with you. They carry the spots of pain in your mind, directing you to attack in the present in retaliation for a past that is no more. And this decision is one of future pain. Unless you learn that the past pain is an illusion, you are choosing a future of illusions and losing of the many opportunities you could find for release in the present. The ego would preserve your nightmares and prevent you from awakening and understanding they are past. Would you recognize a holy encounter if you are merely perceiving it as a meeting with your own past? For you would be meeting no one, and the sharing of salvation, which makes the encounter holy, would be excluded from your sight. The Holy Spirit teaches that you always meet yourself and that the encounter is holy because you are. The ego teaches that you always encounter your past, and because your dreams were not holy, the future cannot be, and the present is without meaning. It is evident that the Holy Spirit's perception of time is the exact opposite of the ego's. The reason is equally clear, for they perceive the goal of time as diametrically opposed. The Holy Spirit interprets time's purpose as rendering the need for time unnecessary. He regards the function of time as temporary, serving only his teaching function, which is temporary by definition. His emphasis is therefore on the only aspect of time that can extend to the infinite, for now is the closest approximation of eternity that this world offers. It is in the reality of now, without past or future, that the beginning of the appreciation of eternity lies. For only now is here, and only now presents the opportunities for the holy encounters in which salvation can be found. The ego, on the other hand, regards the function of time as one of extending itself in place of eternity, for like the Holy Spirit, the ego interprets the goal of time as its own. The continuity of past and future under its direction is the only purpose the ego perceives in time. And it closes over the present so that no gap in its own continuity can occur. Its continuity, then, would keep you in time while the Holy Spirit would release you from it. It is his interpretation of the means of salvation that you must learn to accept if you would share his goal of salvation for you. You too will interpret the function of time as you interpret yours. If you accept your function in the world of time as one of healing, you will emphasize only the aspect of time in which healing can occur. Healing cannot be accomplished in the past. It must be accomplished in the present to release the future. This interpretation ties the future to the present and extends the present rather than the past. But if you interpret your function as destruction, you will lose sight of the present and hold on to the past to ensure a destructive future. And time will be as you interpret it, for of itself, it is nothing. To perceive truly is to be aware of all reality through the awareness of your own. But for this, no illusions can rise to meet your sight, for reality leaves no room for any error. This means that you perceive a brother only as you see him now. His past has no reality in the present, so you cannot see it. Your past reactions to him are also not there. And if it is to them that you react, you see but an image of him that you made and cherish instead of him. In your questioning of illusions, ask yourself if it is really sane to perceive what was as now. If you remember the past as you look upon your brother, you will be unable to perceive the reality that is now. You consider it, quote, natural to use your past experience as the reference point from which to judge the present. Yet this is unnatural because it is delusional. When you have learned to look on everyone with no reference at all to the past, either his or yours as you perceive it, you will be able to learn from what you see now. For the past can cast no shadow to darken the present. unless you are afraid of light. And only if you are would you choose to bring darkness with you, and by holding it in your mind, see it as a dark cloud that shrouds your brothers and conceals their reality from your sight. This darkness is in you. The Christ as revealed to you now has no past, for he is changeless, and in his changelessness lies your release. For if he is as he was created, there is no guilt in him. No cloud of guilt has risen to obscure him, and he stands revealed in everyone you meet, because you see him through himself. To be born again is to let the past go and look without condemnation upon the present. The cloud that obscures God's Son to you is the past. And if you would have it past and gone, you must not see it now. If you see it now in your illusions, it has not gone from you, although it is not there. Time can release as well as imprison, depending on whose interpretation of it you use. Past, present, and future are not continuous unless you force continuity on them. You can perceive them as continuous and make them so for you, but do not be deceived and then believe that this is how it is. For to believe reality is what you would have it be according to your use for it is delusional. You would destroy time's continuity by breaking it into past, present, and future for your own purposes. You would anticipate the future on the basis of your past experience and plan for it accordingly. Yet, by doing so, you are aligning the past and future and not allowing the miracle which could intervene between them to free you to be born again. The miracle enables you to see your brother without his past, and so perceive him as born again. His errors are all past, and by perceiving him without them, you are releasing him. And since his past is yours, you share in this release. Let no dark cloud out of your past obscure him from you, for truth lies only in the present, and you will find it if you seek it there. You have looked for it where it is not, and therefore have not found it. Learn then to seek it where it is, and it will dawn on your eyes that see. Your past was made in anger, and if you use it to attack the present, you will not see the freedom that the present holds. Judgment and condemnation are behind you, and unless you bring them with you, you will see that you are free of them. Look lovingly upon the present, for it holds the only things that are forever true. All healing lies within it, because its continuity is real. It extends to all aspects of the sonship at the same time, and thus enables them to reach each other. The present is before time was, and will be when time is no more. In it are all things that are eternal, and they are one. Their continuity is timeless, and their communication is unbroken, for they are not separated by the past. Only the past can separate, and it is nowhere. The present offers you your brothers in the light that would unite you with them, and free you from the past. Would you then hold the past against them? For if you do, you are choosing to remain in the darkness that is not there, and refusing to accept the light that is offered you. For the light of perfect vision is freely given, as it is freely received, and can be accepted only without limit. In this one still dimension of time that does not change, and where there is no sight of what you were, you look at Christ and call his witnesses to shine on you because you called them forth. And they will not deny the truth in you because you looked for it in them and found it there. Now is the time of salvation, for now is the release from time. Reach out to all your brothers and touch them with the touch of Christ. In timeless union with them is your continuity, unbroken because it is wholly shared. God's guiltless Son is the only light. There is no darkness in him anywhere, for he is whole. Call all your brothers to witness to his wholeness, as I am calling you to join with me. Each voice has a part in the song of redemption, the hymn of gladness, and the thanksgiving for the light to the Creator of light. The holy light that shines forth from God's Son is the witness that his light is of his Father. Shine on your brothers in remembrance of your Creator, for you will remember him as you call forth the witnesses to his creation. Those whom you heal bear witness to your healing, for in their wholeness you will see your own. And as your hymns of praise and gladness rise to your Creator, he will return your thanks in his clear answer to your call. For it can never be that his Son called upon him and remained unanswered. His call to you is but your call to him, and in him you are answered by his peace. Child of light, you know not that the light is in you, yet you will find it through its witnesses. For having given light to them, they will return it. Each one you see in light brings your light closer to your awareness. Love always leads to love. The sick who ask for love are grateful for it, and in their joy they shine with holy thanks. And this they offer you who gave them joy. They are your guides to joy, for having received it of you, they would keep it. You have established them as guides to peace, for you have made it manifest in them. And seeing it, its beauty calls you home. There is a light that this world cannot give, yet you can give it as it was given you. And as you give it, it shines forth to call you from the world and follow it. For this light will attract you as nothing in this world can do, and you will lay aside the world and find another. This other world is bright with love which you have given it, and here will everything remind you of your Father and his Holy Son. Light is unlimited and spreads across this world in quiet joy. All those you brought with you will shine on you, and you will shine on them in gratitude, because they brought you here. Your light will join with theirs in power so compelling that it will draw the others out of darkness as you look on them. Awakening unto Christ is following the laws of love of your free will and out of quiet recognition of the truth in them. The attraction of light must draw you willingly, and willingness is signified by giving. Those who accept love of you become your willing witnesses to the love you gave them, and it is they who hold it out to you. In sleep, you are alone, and your awareness is narrowed to yourself. And that is why the nightmares come. You dream of isolation because your eyes are closed. You do not see your brothers, and in the darkness you cannot look upon the light you gave to them. And yet, the laws of love are not suspended because you sleep, and you have followed them through all your nightmares and have been faithful in your giving, for you were not alone. Even in sleep has Christ protected you, ensuring the real world for you when you awake. In your name he has given for you and given you the gifts he gave. God's Son is still as loving as his Father. Continuous with his Father, he has no past apart from him. So he has never ceased to be his Father's witness and his own. Although he slept, Christ's vision did not leave him. And so it is that he can call unto himself the witnesses that teach him that he never slept. The miracle does nothing. All it does is to undo, and thus it cancels out the interference to what has been done. It does not add, but merely takes away. And what it takes away is long since gone, but being kept in memory appears to have immediate effects. This world was over long ago. The thoughts that made it are no longer in the mind that thought of them and loved them for a little while. The miracle but shows the past is gone, and what has truly gone has no effects. Remembering a cause can but produce illusions of its presence, not effects. All the effects of guilt are here no more, for guilt is over. In its passing went its consequences, left without a cause. Why would you cling to it in memory if you did not desire its effects? Remembering is as selective as perception, being its past tense. It is perception of the past as if it were occurring now and still were there to see. Memory, like perception, is a skill made up by you to take the place of what God gave you in your creation. And like all the things you made, it can be used to serve another purpose and to be the means for something else. It can be used to heal and not to hurt, if you so wish it be. Nothing employed for healing represents an effort to do anything at all. It is a recognition that you have no needs, which mean that something must be done. It is an unselective memory that is not used to interfere with truth. All things the Holy Spirit can employ for healing have been given him without the content and the purposes for which they have been made. They are but skills without an application. They await their use. They have no dedication and no aim. The Holy Spirit can indeed make use of memory, for God himself is there. Yet this is not a memory of past events, but only of a present state. You are so long accustomed to believe that memory holds only what is past, that it is hard for you to realize it is a skill that can remember now. The limitations on remembering the world imposes on it are as vast as those you let the world impose on you. There is no link of memory to the past. If you would have it there, then there it is. But only your desire made the link, and only you have held it to a part of time where guilt appears to linger still. The Holy Spirit's use of memory is quite apart from time. He does not seek to use it as a means to keep the past, but rather as a way to let it go. Memory holds the message it receives and does what it is given to do. It does not write the message, nor appoint what it is for. Like to the body, it is purposeless within itself. And if it seems to serve to cherish ancient hate and gives you pictures of injustices and hurts that you were saving, this is what you ask its message be, and that it is. Committed to its vaults, the history of all the body's past is hidden there. All of the strange associations made to keep the past alive, the present dead, are stored within it, waiting your command as they be brought to you and lived again. And thus do their effects appear to be increased by time, which took away their cause. Yet time is but another phase of what does nothing. It works hand in hand with all the other attributes with which you seek to keep concealed the truth about yourself. Time neither takes away nor can restore, and yet you make strange use of it as if the past had caused the present, which is but a consequence in which no change can be made possible because its cause has gone. Yet change must have a cause that will endure, or else it will not last. No change can be made in the present if its cause is past. Only the past is held in memory as you make use of it, and so it is a way to hold the past against the now. Remember nothing that you taught yourself, for you were badly taught. And who would keep a senseless lesson in his mind when he can learn and can preserve a better one? When ancient memories of hate appear, remember that their cause is gone, and so you cannot understand what they are for. Let not the cause that you would give them now be what it was that made them what they were or seemed to be. Be glad that it is gone. For this is what you would be pardoned from. And see, instead, the new effects of cause accepted now, with consequences here. They will surprise you with their loveliness. The ancient new ideas they bring will be the happy consequences of a cause so ancient that it far exceeds the span of memory which your perception sees. This is the cause the Holy Spirit has remembered for you when you would forget. It is not past because he let it not be unremembered. It has never changed because there never was a time in which he did not keep it safely in your mind. Its consequences will indeed seem new because you thought that you remembered not their cause. Yet was it never absent from your mind, for it was not your Father's will that he be unremembered by his Son. What you remember never was. It came from causelessness, which you confused with cause. It can deserve but laughter when you learn you have remembered consequences that were causeless and could never be effects. The miracle reminds you of a cause forever present, perfectly untouched by time and interference, never changed from what it is, and you are its effect, as changeless and as perfect as itself. Its memory does not lie in the past, nor waits the future. It is without, it is not revealed in miracles, but they remind you that it has not gone. When you forgive it for your sins, it will no longer be denied. You who have sought to lay a judgment on your own creator cannot understand it is not he who laid a judgment on his son. You would deny him his effects, and yet have they never been denied. There was no time in which his son could be condemned, for what was causeless and against his will, what your remembering would witness to is but the fear of God. He has not done the thing you fear, no more have you. And so your innocence has not been lost. You need no healing to be healed. In quietness, see in the miracle a lesson in allowing cause to have its own effects, and doing nothing that would interfere. The miracle comes quietly into the mind that stops an instant and is still. It reaches gently from that quiet time and from the mind it healed in quiet then to other minds to share its quietness. And they will join in doing nothing to prevent its radiant extension back into the mind which caused all minds to be. Born out of sharing, there can be no pause in time to cause the miracle delay in hastening to all unquiet minds and bringing them an instant's stillness when the memory of God returns to them. Their own remembering is quiet now, and what has come to take its place will not be wholly unremembered. Effort words.
Thank you.
revelation, time, and miracles. Revelation induces complete but temporary suspension of doubt and fear. It reflects the original form of communication between God and His creations, evolving the extremely personal sense of creation sometimes sought in physical relationships. Physical closeness cannot achieve it. Miracles, however, are genuinely interpersonal and result in true closeness to others. Revelation unites you directly with God. Miracles unite you directly with your brother. Neither emanates from consciousness, but both are experienced there. Consciousness is the state that induces action, though it does not inspire it. You are free to believe what you choose, and what you do attest to what you believe. Revelation is intensely personal and cannot be meaningfully translated. That is why any attempt to describe it in words is impossible. Revelation induces only experience. Miracles, on the other hand, induce action. They are more useful now because of their interpersonal nature. In this phase of learning, working miracles is important because freedom from fear cannot be thrust upon you. Revelation is literally unspeakable because it is an experience of unspeakable love. Awe should be reserved for revelation, to which it is perfectly and correctly applicable. It is not appropriate for miracles because a state of awe is worshipful, implying that one of a lesser order stands before his creator. You are a perfect creation and should experience awe only in the presence of the creator of perfection. The miracle is therefore a sign of love among equals. Equals should not be in awe of one another because awe implies inequality. It is therefore an inappropriate reaction to me. An elder brother is entitled to respect for his greater experience and obedience for his greater wisdom. He is also entitled to love because he is a brother, and to devotion if he is devoted. It is only my devotion that entitles me to yours. There is nothing about me that you cannot attain. I have nothing that does not come from God. The difference between us now is that I have nothing else. This leaves me in a state which is only potential in you. No man cometh unto the Father but by me does not mean that I am in any way separate or different from you, except in time, and time does not really exist. The statement is more meaningful in terms of a vertical rather than a horizontal axis. You stand below me, and I stand below God. In the process of rising up, I am higher, because without me, the distance between God and man would be too great for you to encompass. I bridge the distance as an elder brother to you on the one hand, and as a son of God on the other. My devotion to my brothers has placed me in charge of the sonship, which I render complete because I share it. This may appear to contradict the statement, I and my Father are one, but there are two parts to the statement in recognition that the Father is greater. Revelations are indirectly inspired by me because I am close to the Holy Spirit and alert to the revelation readiness of my brothers. I can thus bring down to them more than they can draw down to themselves. The Holy Spirit mediates higher to lower communication, keeping the direct channel from God to you open for revelation. Revelation is not reciprocal. It proceeds from God to you, but not from you to God. The miracle minimizes the need for time. in the longitudinal or horizontal plane, the recognition of the equality of the members of the sonship appears to involve almost endless time. However, the miracle entails a sudden shift from horizontal to vertical perception. This introduces an interval from which the giver and receiver both emerge farther along in time than they would otherwise have been. The miracle thus has the unique property of abolishing time to the extent that it renders the interval of time it spans unnecessary. There is no relationship between the time a miracle takes and the time it covers. The miracle substitutes for learning that might have taken thousands of years. It does so by the underlying recognition of the perfect equality of giver and receiver on which the miracle rests. The miracle shortens time by collapsing it, thus eliminating certain intervals within it. It does this, however, within the larger temporal sequence. He to whom time is given offers thanks for every quiet instant given him. For in that instant is God's memory allowed to offer all its treasures to the Son of God, for whom they have been kept. How gladly does he offer them unto the one for whom he has been giving them. And his Creator shares in his thanks, because he would not be deprived of his effects. The instant silence that his Son accepts gives welcome to eternity and him, and lets them enter where they would be. For in that instant does the Son of God do nothing that would make himself afraid. How instantly the memory of God arises in the mind that has no fear to keep the memory away. Its own remembering has gone. There is no past to keep its fearful image in the way of glad awakening to present peace. The trumpets of eternity resound throughout the stillness, yet disturb it not. And what is now remembered is not fear, but rather is the cause that fear was made to render unremembered and undone. The stillness speaks in gentle sounds of love. The Son of God remembers from before his own remembering came in between the present and the past to shut them out. Now, is the Son of God at last aware of present cause and its benign effects? Now does he understand what he has made is causeless, having no effects at all. He has done nothing, and in seeing this, he understands he never had a need for doing anything and never did. His cause is its effects. There was never a cause beside it that could generate a different past or future. Its effects are changelessly eternal, beyond fear and past the world of sin. Only a constant purpose can endow events with stable meaning, but it must accord one meaning to them all. If they are given different meanings, it must be that they reflect different purposes. And this is all the meaning that they have. Can this be meaning? Can confusion be what meaning means? Perception cannot be in constant flux and make allowance for stability of meaning anywhere. Fear is a judgment never justified. Its presence has no meaning but to show you wrote a fearful script and are afraid accordingly, but not because the thing you fear has fearful meaning in itself. A common purpose is the only means by where perception can be stabilized, and one interpretation given to the world and all experiences here. In this shared purpose is one judgment shared by everyone and everything you see. You do not have to judge, for you have learned one meaning has been given everything, and you are glad to see it everywhere. It cannot change because you would preserve it. I see only the past. This idea is particularly difficult to believe at first. Yet it is the rationale for all the preceding ones. It is the reason why nothing that you see means anything. It is the reason why you have given everything you see all the meaning that it has for you. It is the reason why you do not understand anything you see. It is the reason why your thoughts do not mean anything and why they are like the things you see. It is the reason why you are never upset for the reason you think. It is the reason why you are upset because you see something that is not there. Old ideas about time are very difficult to change because everything you believe is rooted in time and depends on your not learning these new ideas about it. Yet that is precisely why you need new ideas about time. This first time idea is not really so strange as it may sound at first. Look at a cup, for example. Do you see a cup, or are you merely reviewing your past experiences of picking up a cup, being thirsty, drinking from a cup, feeling the rim of a cup against your lips, having breakfast, and so on? Are not your aesthetic reactions to the cup too based on past experiences? How else would you know whether or not this kind of cup will break if you drop it? What do you know about this cup except what you learned in the past? You would have no idea what this cup is except for your past learning. Do you then really see it? My mind is preoccupied with past thoughts. This idea is, of course, the reason why you see only the past. No one really sees anything. He sees only his thoughts projected outward. The mind's preoccupation with the past is the cause of the misconception about time from which your seeing suffers. Your mind cannot grasp the present, which is the only time there is. It therefore cannot understand time and cannot, in fact, understand anything. The one holy true thought one can hold about the past is that it is not here. To think about it at all is therefore to think about illusions. Very few have realized what is actually entailed in picturing the past or in anticipating the future. The mind is actually blank when it does this, because it is not really thinking about anything. I see nothing as it is now. This idea obviously follows from the two preceding ones. But while you may be able to accept it intellectually, it is unlikely that it will mean anything to you as yet. However, understanding is not necessary at this point. In fact, the recognition that you do not understand is a prerequisite for undoing your false ideas. These exercises are concerned with practice, not with understanding. You do not need to practice what you already understand. It would indeed be circular to aim at understanding and assume that you have it already. It is difficult for the untrained mind to believe that what it seems to picture is not there. This idea can be quite disturbing and may meet with active resistance in any number of forms. Yet that does not preclude applying it. No more than that is required for these or any other exercises. Each small step will clear a little of the darkness away, and understanding will finally come to lighten every corner of the mind that has been cleared of the debris that darkens it. My thoughts do not mean anything. This idea applies to all the thoughts of which you are aware or become aware in the practice periods. The reason the idea is applicable to all of them is that they are not your real thoughts. We have made this distinction before and will do so again. You have no basis for comparison as yet. When you do, you will have no doubt that what you once believed were your thoughts did not mean anything. This is the second time we have used this kind of idea. The form is only slightly different. This time the idea is introduced with my thoughts instead of these thoughts, and no link is made overtly with the things around you. The emphasis is now on the lack of reality of what you think you think. This aspect of the correction process began with the idea that the thoughts of which you are aware are meaningless, outside rather than within, and then stress their past rather than their present status. Now we are emphasizing that the presence of these, quote, thoughts means that you are not thinking. This is merely another way of repeating our earlier statement that your mind is really blank. To recognize this is to recognize nothingness when you think you see it. As such, it is the prerequisite for vision. So we thank Jesus for these amazing pointers to the eternal present. We have been given spectacular instructions to be still, to sink into stillness, to release what never was. And I give thanks for all the blessed and beloved movies that the Holy Spirit brings to make clear this transformation of mind, that help us transfer the training and learn to think in miracles and perceive miraculously. It is possible to think with God instead of trying to think and perceive apart from our source. And I'm grateful for every movie symbol, every symbol of the dream as it points us inward to the stately calm within, a peaceful, quiet, tranquil mind is not a small gift. So as we watch these time movies, and they point us beyond time, to the timeless, to the eternal life that is shared with God, our beloved Creator, we give thanks. Amen.